And we're going to sit here for another few minutes before moving on. And while we do that, let's go see what Steph's up to.
Welcome back. Have a look at this little Steenbok that's there. Copy that. I'd like to come and join you at that sighting if you don't mind. Copy that, will do. Alright, so that was a Steenbok. Sorry, excuse me for not identifying that to you as we stopped there. I was just busy speaking to Mike on the radio as you came across to us. That was a little Steenbok standing quite still. Unusual for them is that they usually dash off at the first sign of you stopping or pointing the camera at them in any particular way. Alright, I think what we're going to do is we're going to go and visit young Sindile. That particular sighting is hasn't gathered the attention this morning yet. For some or other odd reason, it seems like he's been left to his own devices. One or two people have gone in there after Brent, and then it seems like everyone's left him alone. All right. Dina, you've asked if myself and the other presenters get any sore necks from constantly turning around. No, we don't, Dina. Not really, I don't think. I mean, we're all getting a bit older, and I think the usual aches and pains associated to being strapped to a car that bounces around, you know, is prevalent, but nothing much, nothing more than that. Thanks for asking. All right, getting up to the sandy patch road, which is what I want to go on. There was some elephant here with Brent a little while ago. Maybe they've moved on. It's always an interesting place, this, in that they did some hippo capturing or relocation here as the drought started. The Sabi Sands jumped on the wagon quite quickly and realized that these hippos are going to run out of food to eat, and so they moved them into areas of the country that has a little bit more food, and also in a way to sort of reseed dams and rivers in other parts of the country that don't have hippo. Hippo and man have been in sort of a conflict with one another for centuries, because the arable land next to riverbeds and next to dams is quite often populated by hippo, and hippo are aggressive. You know, they want to eat what they want to eat, and they want to live where they want to live. And it is difficult to protect yourself. You know, if you can imagine a rural peasant of some sort hacking a living out of the ground using a stick and basic hand implements, it's very, very difficult to protect yourself from a hippo. And because of that, over the centuries, man has sort of eradicated hippo from most water bodies around the country, and they really were only confined to the game reserves for many, many, many years. And it's become a recent sort of endeavor to basically reseed dams and pans around the country with hippo and spread them away from these nature reserves. I quite enjoy that sort of concept, moving animals out of national parks and back into these protected sanctuaries. So Carly, welcome to the Wild Earth family and welcome aboard. You're a new viewer and welcome to this community. I'm sure you'll be welcomed with open arms. You've said that you love this stream, and I've just bumped into some elephant. Because I've bumped into some elephant here, I've completely forgotten what you asked me, Carly. Please excuse me. Well, here we go. Ah, yes, you've asked me what is my favorite part of the job. Collie, exactly what you've just seen me do now. Lose my mind because I've come around a corner and there are some elephant in front of me. All right, let me just get hold of Brent. He's desperately trying to get hold of me as well. So you have a look at this elephant. I'm going to be speaking on the radio to Brent. Go with your message, Brent. These elephants are very peaceful, looking good. Just flitting around in the leaf litter. Have a look at that foot. The size of a dustbin lid and worn smooth. With all those cracks in the bottom, very, very good trackers can actually track an elephant from the pattern that is cracked into the bottom of an elephant's foot. I've seen scars on the bottom of an elephant's foot where they've cut their feet open, and that's become quite prevalent. But I must say, I'm not that good a tracker yet that I could pick out one elephant's foot from another. And that is basically just skin. It's exactly the same as the bottom of our feet, by the way. They're just much more calloused and much more cracked. But quite soft. Same as if you had to feel your heel, knowing that you have a heel bone inside there, but your heel is covered with that fatty deposit, that elasticy fatty deposit with the hard skin on the outside. That is exactly. Just look at that elephant curling the trunk. Absolutely peaceful, at rest with one another. This is a family group made up of a matriarch, the oldest and wisest female, and all her offspring. And potentially a sister with all the sisters' offspring, but generally it's between sort of 6 and 12 elephant, these herds. Oh, and also her daughter's offspring as well. Elephants live long enough that their herds can be comprised of mom, daughter, and subsequent daughters and cousins as well. With the immature bulls leaving the herd anywhere between sort of 12 years and 18 years old to begin their wanderings. And they will wander the bushveld for until they're around about 35 to 40 years old, and that is the time when they'll only be big enough to compete for the mating rights with females. They're between 35 and about 45 or 40 years old. So Belu Rushwin, you've just asked me, why do elephants keep their legs bent from time to time? Belu, I think it's just a restful attitude. It's a similar to how you cross your legs in front of the TV or cross your legs at a desk, perhaps put your one leg on top of the other one. I think it's just a way of relaxing that particular appendage. Oh, look at this young bull walking across the road. So Belu, just to conclude that point, I don't think that there's any meaningful deep thing about it. I think it's literally just a relaxation pose, you know, relaxing that particular leg or that particular muscle group, stretching it out perhaps. Ah. Kurt, all the way from Switzerland, has just sent me a message to say that he is visiting the Kruger National Park next week, Well, I'm looking forward to that, Kurt. You must be very excited already at this particular point. And you said, how will you know if an elephant's upset with you? All right, we're just going to send you over to Brent. He may have something very special to show you.
Okay, so we're on the tracks of those dogs. We heard them calling. Then they appeared behind us already. And now Aubrey said they went into Buffalo's Hook, but there they are. Come back to Djuma. There we go. An early birthday present for me. My favorite animal, the African wild dog. That's so exciting. Hello, puppies. Now this is looks like the dispersal pack from the Loisabi. And I want to see if they're going to den late. So I'm trying to see if the female, where is she? She's up in head. No. She's not looking pregnant. Nkomo Shinen! There we go. They're going back onto Djuma. No, they're going down Buffalo's Hook boundary. So isn't that incredible? From where we heard them, they're probably about 3 or 4 kilometers already. Look, they're going into Djuma. Yay! Okay, time to engage low range. I might have to break my wide angle rule for the day. Put the big lens on. Oh, they are coming close enough. Will we get a wide angle shot? Now that's what we heard. That's what we heard not 10 minutes ago. That put us in the mad dash after the dogs. Well, X-Ranger says it sounds like the noise a phone makes when you hang up on someone. Well, fortunately, I don't use phones too often. For me, it's the sound of excitement. Now maybe it isn't the Loisabi. I mean, I have to get some pictures to send to Grant so he can ID for me exactly. Don't go back that way, that's the wrong way. Looks like they're going back towards So we're going to stick around. They are crossing. Oh, don't go that way, guys. Okay, hold on, we need to turn around. So we're going to stay with the dogs while we've got the visuals. We're not going to, if they keep going that way, we're going to lose visuals. So let's get the last visuals of them. But they are zigzagging and going up and down. Let's get a last visual there. They might come back. So we're not going to move too far from this area because they've been north and come back south already. Oh, isn't that stunning? Even if it is just the briefest of visuals, I am a happy, happy camper. Okay, so they've disappeared. I'm gonna try to calm down for a second. I'm just really happy we got to see them. But while we calm down, let's go back across to Steph with the calming elephants. Oh, apparently we're staying with me. Okay, so it looks like they might be going. We're gonna try stay around here. They might come back south. So I'm just gonna see where the vehicles are going. They seem to be going northeast. Now, we're just going to sit here. Jen is wondering, well, if all the dogs are together, who are they calling to? Jen, they're a dispersal pack, and they've got quite a sad history, unfortunately. So what happened is that an outbreak of canine distemper wiped out the rest of their pack. So they could still be calling for the members that are already dead. They could be looking for new pack members. So the one thing about being three survivors from a big pack like that, they're almost certainly related. So they're going to need to find, probably just judging that the fact that there are two males and one female, they're going to have to find an unrelated male or two unrelated males to form a new alpha pair. So that's what they're calling for more than likely. And I've got some really interesting news. I went to see my friends Tristan and Ali last night, and there are two males that have dispersed from the Sands pack. So hopefully, if we're really lucky, that those two will meet up. And they weren't far from here last night. So maybe that's who they're calling for. Maybe these weren't the dogs we heard calling. Maybe it was the dispersal guys. So I think I might meander back that way and see if maybe those two males are coming. Wouldn't that be incredible to have a third pack of wild dogs here? It would be absolutely amazing. And let's just hope they decide this is the spot to hang out in and den. I'm just listening to where the cars are going. It sounds like they're going a little bit further to the east, so we're just going to roll down the hill. I'm half expecting to just see Impala dashing. Okay, it looks like they're coming back south. So Ellen in Arkansas has noticed that that wild dog put its head to the ground when it's calling. So in the exact same way as a hyena does to try and project that sound further. I saw the vehicles up there, and I'm trying to see if they're coming back down. Orbs. When we get a gap, I saw the vehicles up there. They seem to be coming this way, but I'm just listening carefully. Okay, they've turned north again. But they could easily pop back out. So we're sitting out on the road again with long views in each way, different long road. And listening to the cars with great jealousy as they crash after the wild dogs. What to do now? What do you spot with them? Oh, a battalier. Now, he'll be hoping the wild dogs make a kill and can get a snack. I can still hear the vehicles. Now, David's wondering, are those dogs hunting? I would say probably not, David. I'm just listening, sorry. So, David says, are they hunting? It doesn't look like it because they are calling. I think they're looking for more members to join that pack. But being wild dogs, if they see an impala, they will chase it, like most predators. Okay, they're going back slightly to the west, but unfortunately not where we can see it. Okay, we're going to keep on the patrol around here in case those dogs decide to come back. While we do that, let's go see how Steph's doing.
Painted wolf that you're stolen away from. Isn't that fantastic that we got to see them, hey? Days like this, I tell you, it's been such a phenomenal last few days here. And it's such a typical example of this dry season animals just coming in from everywhere to sort of be around. The antelope are coming in for water, predators are coming in for food, and then on top of it you get one of Africa's rarest large carnivores, the African wild dog, to share with. And of course Brent's incitement and enthusiasm for it. For me, I'd rather choose to stay at a more sedate pace and look for the smaller, more scurrying creatures. Now, we're trying to find where Sindile has his kill in a tree. Ah. And Kurt, I just want to now finish, now that the excitement has sort of is subsided a bit, so I just want to finish my my pointers for you visiting the Kruger National Park. And you're worried about elephant. You're worried about, how do you tell that an elephant is cross with you? Well, Kurt, the first thing is always give elephant right of way. So when you can see them walking down the road, let them walk down the road. If you see them wanting to cross from left to right or from right to left, once again, that is what you must let them do. Don't get in their way, basically. That's the rule number one when dealing with with elephants. Other than that, a very upright posture. So head up, ears out, and bearing down on you. You want to try and avoid situations like that. And the easiest way to do that is, of course, just to create distance. So if you're ever in a situation where an elephant is trying to bear down on you, it just feels like they're trying to assert dominance over you, ears out, head up, that is exactly what you need to do, is listen to that and create distance. Elephant usually calm down, I would say, 99% of the time. All right, now, excuse me breaking off from that, Kurt. I'll get back to you in a second, but somewhere around here we have a leopard. And I'm just trying to, oh, okay, I've got the kill. I haven't been in the sighting just yet, so I can see the kill is in the tree in front of us. And obviously doesn't have a leopard attached to it. So last time he was here, he was eating a piece.
Oh, there he is. Just straight there. Straight through.
So Brian is... Oh, okay, I've got him. All right. So we've got him. He's lying in the shade just to the side of the kill. So let's go there. Well done, Mr. Brian. Spotted his unmistakable silhouette in the shade of the tree. All right, lying in that such typical pose, that relaxed on the side cat pose. We're going to see if we can get you into a nice place to view him without looking at the back of his head. All right, so Kurt, the idea is literally just to relax around elephant, give them right of way, and if they show any sort of overtly domineering, if you feel like you're being dominated, then just create distance with elephant, and that should solve 9 out of 10 of your problems. We're just going to go around to where he's lying at the moment. Looks like he's been lying underneath this bush for most of the morning. There's a few tracks here of cars that have come in and out. I don't want to let him get scared. Yesterday when I was looking at him from the final control, you're going to be okay here, Mr. Brian. Let's see if I can thread your camera through here and the aerial. All good. Yesterday when I was looking at his reactions from the final control, he seemed like he was a little bit on edge with vehicles and with people. And no wonder, I think he's warranted as having full right to dislike people. I'm going to make a statement here that may seem bizarre, but this is the first time that I lay my eyes upon young Sindile. I have never seen this leopard before. Yeah. Not in all the time that we had all those beautiful visuals of him and James creating that almost, you know, that bond with him, basically. I don't know how else to put it. Not in any of that time was I lucky enough to see Sindile. This is the first time that I'm laying my own eyes on him, and he is actually a beautiful cat. He's well proportioned, he's well muscled. I agree with Brent, I quite enjoy the color of his coat. He's got this history that we now know about him, and that endears him to us, or to me at least anyway. But Justin, you've asked me how much does an adult leopard weigh. Now, they're very variable in their weight, Justin. And the reason for that is because they're so highly adaptable. They fill niches, literally, from the borders of our towns and our cities, even. Pretoria and Nelspruit are frequently visited by leopard. Leopard also inhabit mountainous regions and all the way into the jungles in Central Africa. And they get bigger the more tropical the area gets. And I think it's just because of the prey availability. So in places like the Sabi Sands here, going into Botswana and in Zambia, you find the heaviest leopard. With the heaviest leopard ever measured at around about 110 kilograms, which is about 220, 230 pounds. With the heaviest leopard in the Sabi Sand ever measured at about 90 kilograms or 95 kilograms. Brent knows the exact weight, but it's somewhere around the 90 kilograms. We to help this young guy. And two is you don't want an animal that is habituated to vehicles like this being set free where the potential for human animal interaction is high. We wanted to make 100% sure that this animal wasn't going to create a threat to human life. And so that's why he was quarantined for all that time. He was then released where he was caught, and contrary to popular belief, instead of dispersing very, very far, which is the norm, he basically traveled, I don't know, 40, 50 miles away from where we are now, and then came back and is now with a fresh kill, literally a mile or two from where he was born. And is a bit of an enigma to the local scientists.
And for that reason, he has that collar on. He is a science. He is adding to science by the second. You can see it over there. Many, many animals get collared. It's a practice that has been happening for decades and with little to no effect to this animal's health and well-being whatsoever. Carly, you've just asked me if we've had any experiences, dangerous experiences with animals. Carly, all the time. You get it wrong sometimes with these animals. As much as what we've been around and seeing animal behavior and being part of these animals' lives, you sometimes do tread over that boundary and animals will warn you. You know, a leopard, for instance, that is fine one day and a week later is hungry or feels chased around or has been harassed by a lion might turn around and charge a car or charge you on foot for no reason other than he's just feeling a bit grumpy that day or a bit edgy that day. And there's no real protection we have. We sit in open vehicles here. And, you know, you can get, and there's, let me say, the potential is there for animals to do people harm all the time. The reality is that they don't really. And that quite often you just get a big fright. That animal chastises you absolutely. And you get a big fright and those boundaries are re-established and re-evaluated. And you carry on with your day. The odd occasion that an animal does follow through and attack a human being is not rare. A couple of times a year in this country, animals will kill humans. But compared to the sheer weight of game drives going out in a day and the amount of tourists that come and visit our national parks throughout Africa, those incidences are a fraction of a fraction. And can almost always be traced to either humans making a promise, a human error. Oh, I've just been talking about being chastised. I have my facts slightly wrong there. Sindile didn't or wasn't bitten by the dog. He bit the dog with rabies. There was a chance that he was infected by the rabies virus through the dog's saliva, which could have penetrated his skin or have in somehow or in some way infected him. We just took the necessary precautions for the reasons that I did mention, though. So he didn't actually get rabies, but he was vaccinated against it and he was held in quarantine just in case. So please excuse me for that. Forgetting myself here. Right, and while we watching him relax in the shade with his impala full or his belly full of impala, Brent, I'm sure, has an update for you on what's happened with those dogs.
Unfortunately, those dogs kept heading north, but Herbie found the remains of a kill the lions made last night in this block. So we're just checking now down to the east, making sure they haven't crossed this way. And then we're going to start heading back up towards Mvubu Road. Hopefully, if they have made a kill, they're going to head towards the Pan for a drink at Galago. So we're going to go have a look there now. But we're just going very slowly, making sure we don't miss any tracks. What a busy morning. Wow, those dogs move fast. They're now, from where we saw them, probably 3-4 kilometers. Heading east. Now, I keep hoping to spot an eagle owl in this tree. James Richard says, when I blow out my birthday candles tomorrow, maybe I should wish for a wild dog den on Djuma. Well, I'm actually going to be very lucky on my birthday because I'm going to go see my parents at their house, and 600 meters from the house is a wild dog den with babies. So I will see wild dogs and babies on my birthday. And speaking of babies, look at the little Nyala. Aren't you lucky, little Nyala? The wild dogs didn't come this way. Nice little group of females. Doing some grooming. You can see how ruffled their neck and whatnot is. And that's from grooming and aloe grooming. And if we have a look a little bit to the right, oh, there we go. There's two female Nyala aloe grooming each other. And that's why they've got those funny looking necks, all puffed up, fluffed up. And the baby is obviously being groomed by everyone because he's fluffed up everywhere. Yeah, I think Aubrey might be on foot. Look at that. Isn't that wonderful? It's not too often we get to see nice aloe grooming from antelope. Let the little Nyala family keep moving as they head off behind us. We're going to carry on looking for lions. Now, Dara in Ohio says ruminants must not have a gag reflex. Well, that's true, and since they purposely bring up food on a constant basis to chew the cud. Okay. Ooh. Have we in that tree? That's an interesting looking little bird from a distance. Let's get a bit closer. Oh, there we go. Now this could be a new bird species for a few people. There, isn't that pretty? That is a little mosque swallow. A mosque swallow. I wonder who's got mosque swallow on their bird list. Hopefully it's a new one for a few of you. You have them chirping away, basking in the early morning light. There we go, lovely little birds. Off. If one went, are the others going to follow? Oh, coming back in. Zoom, boop, there we go. Went for a little swoop. Maybe caught an insect. There we go. There's that very distinct swallow call. Leave the swallows to their morning grooming. So while we continue searching, let's go back to Steph and how exciting with his first ever sighting of young Sindile.
It is quite nice profound meeting a new leopard for a first time, especially one that's as relaxed as this. It's just quite a nice. We would be sitting here enjoying the warmth of the sun, looking at the color of the blue in the sky, and then we just marveling at the fact that we've got this leopard lying 15 feet or 15 yards away from us, pretty much oblivious to the fact that we're here. And at peace, surrounded by lion, surrounded by wild dog, surrounded by elephant, and we've got this little island of calm here. Now, he's got an impala in the tree. He's eaten, I suppose, now around about 80-90% of it. Birdie, you've asked me how often do leopard eat. Birdie, leopard will eat as often as they are able to catch something. So they're opportunistic. So even though his belly is full at the moment, he's pretty much swallowed that entire impala that you're having a look at over there now. If another impala had to walk past you, he would jump up and he'd kill it if he can. But they can go for several weeks without food. They've got a pretty high metabolism, and therefore this impala that you're looking at now will only really last him, from a metabolic point of view, no more than 2 weeks. And he'll be hunting again desperately probably 4 to 5 days from now. They get hungry like you and I do, I think, just from my observations in the bush. You know, after a full meal, you don't need to eat that night. If you have a big lunch, you don't need to eat that night. Potentially the next morning you'd feel a bit snacky, but by lunchtime your tummy's going to begin growling again. And by dinner of the following night, doesn't matter how much you ate the previous day, you're going to want to eat something. And you could possibly push through that day and maybe the next day, but by day three you're going to be feeling it. It's exactly the same with leopard. You see this casual hunting turn into a sort of desperation here at about 4 days to a week or so, and then they usually come right. How long can they last? I've seen an injured leopard, a leopard that was bashed around a bit by lion, last about 2 weeks, get to a point where literally their skin looks like they just stretched over a skeleton. Their body starts to use the muscle fibers for energy at about 10 days to 2 weeks. And although I think it can probably last about 3 weeks without food, I think at that point they would need to find something dead to eat. They wouldn't be in a position to catch anything anymore. So we have got a much higher tolerance for starvation than what they have, and I can only put that down to them having a higher metabolism than what we have. Although, you know, the hunger pangs, as I've just described them, are pretty similar. What a nice view of his whiskers at this particular point. Those whiskers are to aid him hunting in the dark. They're there to help him feel gaps in the vegetation. And they are very attached to very sensitive nerves. And it's just the light allowing us to capture those whiskers. They're beautiful. My favorite spot on a leopard. You know, over the last couple of days we've had... I'll finish this now in a second. And I'll finish what I was saying in a bit, just to answer Red Dog's question on is Sindile big for his age? No, I don't think so, Red Dog. He's probably, I don't know, once again, excuse me for not knowing the exact facts of when he was born, but I suppose, how old do you say he's now, Brian? He's a year and a half now.
Say about
20
months or so.
Yeah, 20 months to 24, you know, somewhere around there. He's not particularly big for his age. I think, comparatively speaking, to young male leopard in this particular area, he's probably average, maybe slightly above average. As to leopards in the country, yes, he'd be well above average, I think, the total average of leopard weights across the country, just because he is in the Sabi Sands. And his father is probably one of the following males, the Anderson male, or Mvula, or Tingana, I'm not too sure. And they're all big leopard. Those leopard are all enormous leopard. His mom isn't particularly big. And neither is his grandmother. But, you know, he's got good genes in him, that's for sure. And who knows what he'll actually turn into. Now, my favorite part of a leopard, just to come back to that, is exactly where you're going to now. That saddle that you're looking at there, with those rosettes, those dots of color, is my favorite part on a leopard. It's just that coat that goes from the single or the smaller dot across the shoulders to the actual large rosette across the pelvis, to me, is just an absolutely fantastic part of a leopard. Beautiful, beautiful coloring. Disruptive patterning, that's what that's called, or disruptive camouflage. And those rosettes and that black mark is to break up the silhouette of the leopard. Very similar to how military fatigues have blotches of different colors on them. It's to break up the silhouette. It's to allow the eye not to follow a straight line. And it's that straight line that usually gives away the presence of a predator. Ah, so Michael's just provided some fact here to my repertoire here about Sindile. Thank you very, very much, Michael. Michael said that Sindile will be 2 years old next month. So slightly older than my year and a half and a little bit older than Brian's 20-month prediction. But so he's 23 months old at the moment and therefore exactly how big he should be for this particular area. Yes, look at those whiskers, just long and beautiful, lustrous whiskers. Diamond, you're a new viewer, and I just want to say welcome, and you couldn't have picked a better time to join. We've got a leopard in view here. This is a very well-known leopard called Sindile, and you just asked me how much does this particular leopard weigh. I'd say he's probably in the region of about 50 kilograms at the moment. Yeah, I'd say about 50 kilograms, maybe slightly lower, between 40 and 50 kilograms, which is between, 80 to 100 pounds around about. And he'll almost double in weight by the time he's an adult, which will happen in about 3 years' time. So he's almost two, he's going to change position, maybe. Yeah, he's just moving out of the way of that stick. Lying in the cool sand. Stretching his way out there. He's now a little bit more alert than he was. Leopard, they eat a little bit, come down the tree. They hardly ever sleep in the same tree that they feed in. So Daniel, you've just asked me how big this particular cat's territory is and do they overlap? Daniel, he doesn't have a territory just yet. He has what we call a home range. It's a range that he wanders in. The reason he doesn't have a territory yet is because he's still considered an adolescent. He has left his mom. He's definitely alone at the moment and capable, fully capable of looking after himself. But he doesn't have a territory just yet. He isn't starting to mark and to roar. That'll happen in about 3 years' time. And then your second part of your question, you wanted to know if leopard territories overlap. And no, they don't overlap. They have quite rigid borders, except that the borders are very fluid. So male leopard territories don't overlap. They're not like lion territories. But the edges of the borders are very fluid. And for years, it was decided, I suppose, it was a common knowledge that leopard had core territories which never overlapped with one another and home ranges that did overlap with one another. But the current understanding is that they have a territory that with no overlap but with a boundary that is fluid depending on their condition. So the boundary will move. Very similar to how an amoeba is, I suppose. As I was saying, leopard will eat until they're full, and then they will go, and usually they'll go and sleep away from the tree that their food is in. And the reason for that is that should a lion or another leopard run in here, the intruder will be focused on the food and not on the cat, and it'll give the leopard time to make an escape, even though at the cost of his dinner. But the leopard will move away. And it's just a very good thing to see that he's taking these precautions instinctively. Just goes down to show you that, you know, good breeding from very successful parents is a good strategy for success. And he has a very good mom. In actual fact, his mom comes from good breeding stock. He's one of his mother's only surviving cubs. Me personally, I don't think it's got anything to do with her mothering skills whatsoever. I think it's got everything to do with where she finally chose to put up her territory. And I think that she loses her cubs because of the massive clan of hyena, mostly, that is wandering around her territory. That is my own personal opinion, at least, anyway. Excuse me battling around here with my microphone if you're getting these funny noises coming through. I'm just trying to keep the microphone in a place that doesn't let my voice fade and get muffled. I'm turning my head too much. Brian's giving me the evil eye here. I'll just face my microphone and stop moving around. Yeah, he's sleeping again. So, once again, just he's got a kill right here. Then they don't need water. They just need the meat. They get all their fluid from that. And so he's actually quite content to just stay here and make sure that all that meat gets turned into fat, if it can, before moving on to the next thing. All right. And on that note, and with Sindile now fast asleep again, I think we're going to send you over to Brent, who has managed to dredge up a surprise for you. Ooh, sorry. See you later.
Here we go, the Nkuhumas, and we have Herbie to thank. He's been tracking them all morning, and then suddenly a bush started talking to him. And what we mean is the bush started growling. And here we go, it looks like the lionesses and the cubs. They were walking down this little river system. I'm going to wait to see if they keep coming. It looks like they might keep walking towards us. If they do decide to go to sleep there, we might have to do some repositioning. Oh, there we go. That's even better if she comes up and out of the river. Wonderful. Well, I thought she was going to make it difficult for us, but she seems to be making it easier. It'll be nice if they come lie out in the open here. Looked like she was going to pop out somewhere right here. Or she lay down in the shade. Let's go have a look. What a morning! And strangely enough, we've had lion, now leopard, and wild dogs all within about 1,000 acres. This northeastern corner of Djuma has been incredibly productive this morning. Where was she? There she is. And all the cubs! Hi, guys! So she's coming out of the river. Oh, there's the rest of the pride lying up just here. Let me just go forward. Let's see if we can get a view through here. Okay, how's that, Vimp? Morning, guys. Seems like you had a successful evening. I'm not sure what you caught. I'm going to ask Herbie.
Herbie coming? Thank you very much, Herbie. What did they bomber?
happy, thanks. So it was something small, like a kudu or a waterback. Affirm, Orbs, confirm, are you on the western side of that Shkova? Sorry guys, just got to get Aubrey in here quickly. Orbs, just come to the Mnisikai, you should get my visual. They're coming out of the Shkova onto the eastern bank. Oh, sounds like there's much happening behind us. Stop in a second and we're going to be able to hear all the noises of the wonderful little cubs. Sorry guys.
Obi, do you have my visual?
This, isn't this just too special? We are so lucky to spend as much time. But quickly to Sindile, it looks like he's going to go back up the tree.
Does indeed look like Sindile is going to go back up the tree. Just be diving out of the way here. Yeah, it looks like he is hungry again. You see that twitch of his tail. Giving away his mood. Let's see which direction he chooses to go. He might just choose to lie down there. No, he's looking up at the food. Let's see what. Doesn't have much left. And at this particular point, there's always the danger that the food falls out of the tree. No, he's decided to go and change location to sleep in. Look at how he blends into those leaves in the background. Just absolutely fantastic. And you can see that disruptive coloration there on the right-hand side of his neck in the shade. Try and follow the line of the leopard there and you'll see that where the black spot comes, your eye almost breaks the line of his pattern there. It wants to follow a line, but because of those dark blotches and spots, it almost gives it a jagged edge. And that is his camouflage working. Can you imagine that at night time? You can imagine that in much thicker bush. At a different time of year would render this leopard almost invisible. And on that point, I think we send you back to Brent with those fantastic little lion cubs.
Look at that. So she's just lying under a nice timbuktu tree at the bottom of a spike thorn thicket. And the cubs are feeding, but I think they're getting a little bit aggressive, so she might stand up. So I moved to try to predict where she might walk. Now, other lioness that we initially saw, looks like she's going to come in behind those ones. So I've only seen two lionesses so far. I haven't seen any of the others. There she's about to come out. There she is. Isn't this just wonderful? Oh, here we go. Hello, trouble. That's very kind of you little ones to come lie out in the open. Nkuhuma cub acuteness. Hello, Bella. Bella Rushwin would like to know, is it true that the female lion is the one who does all the hunting and finds the food? Not completely true. Now, the males spend quite a lot of time away from the females, defending their area, patrolling their territory. So when they're not with the prides, they do a lot of their own hunting. And generally, they're very good at hunting big animals, such as buffalo and hippo in this area. Still only two lionesses. Now, they could quite easily be... No, I got three lionesses now. I said there could quite easily be the rest of them hidden beyond these thickets. And you can just make out the third lioness and a cub through the spike thorn thicket. Okay, it looks like there's some more cubs going down there. I'm just going to move forward a little bit so we can see if we can get a gap through there. One little stump in the way, just hang on a second. I just need to change my angle slightly. Just to miss this big stump next to us. How's that for him? I think we're at quite a precarious angle, so but it's worth it though to see those little ones with their mom. Now, after all that maneuvering we did to get here, she's moving away. But the cubs are going to follow her, more than likely. So we'll just wait for them to move before we move. Now, Blobbert McBlob. Is with that lion fight that happened yesterday. Oh, and there's the last cub. Off he goes. Now, we're probably sitting, what angle would you say, Vim?
38
degrees, there we go, Vim, exactly. 38 degrees facing down. So I'm gonna reverse backwards to get into a better position again. While we do that, let's go back to Steph.
Well, Sindile is actually quite aware of what's going on. He hasn't laid down to sleep at all. I think he's getting ready to jump up into that tree and to finish off the last little bit of his food. You can see him looking blissfully at his meal, catching a scent on the air. He seems very at ease, very relaxed. Not a care in the world, actually. Once again, just coming back to the anomaly that is this cat. Generally, dispersal male leopard wander from or through territory to territory, getting pushed out by the dominant male in that particular area until they either find a void that has no male leopard. A male leopard may have been killed or died of disease or whatever. Or they eventually become big enough to fight for a territory and to squash themselves either into a territory or to expel a male leopard that was there through a fight. This particular male leopard has come into an area that has one close. Anderson, I don't think, comes all the way here, but definitely Tingana and Mvula are definitely crawling all over this particular patch. He has been seen sharing a kill with Mvula or Angijima as well. Was it Mvula that he was sharing a kill with the other day?
I'm not too sure.
Or Tingana, I can't remember which one. But he was sharing a kill the other day with an older male. It was Mvula. He was sharing a kill with Mvula the other day, which is not uncommon for the father of a cub to do with an adolescent. So it's not uncommon behavior there. Rare to see two male leopards, especially two independent male leopards in a tree together, but not unheard of and not unexpected, at least anyway, for the father of that particular male. And at 2 years, let me just think about what I've seen amongst leopard before. I mean, the fact that he's wandered so far and has come back to his natal range is actually what's astounding. The presence of an adolescent male in his natal range at 2 years of age is in itself not that remarkable. Male leopard will only really start to leave. If we look at just the recent examples of Nkuhuma and Quarantine, they only leave at 2 years plus their natal range. Incidentally, both of those male leopard Quarantine has set up a territory probably about 10 kilometers from here in Cheetah Plains. And I don't know if he's actively defending it yet, but he's definitely there. And Nkuhuma gave a dominant male leopard called the airstrip male a hiding the other day in a bit of a territorial display. So he's starting to exhibit that stubbornness that is inherent of these of dominant male leopards. But they're obviously much older than this youngster. So I fully expect him to actually move on at a point. With the exception that he wandered so far when he was dropped back here. Easily 50 miles from here. In a massive circle. I think it'll be the cause of much debate in years to come as to exactly why. There's a theory on the table at the moment that because the Kruger National Park has closed off all its watering points, that prey was just so limited that no matter in which direction he went, he couldn't find enough to eat. And the Sabi Sands, having a lot of surface water and a lot of prey animals, was just the natural place for him to come. And it just so happens to have led him back to his natal range. So James Richard has just asked me, since I've now seen Sindile, do I have any other male leopards on my bucket list? James, immediately what springs to mind is just, I'd love to see this Anderson male that everyone keeps on talking about. Apparently he's an absolute enormous leopard. So I'd love to see him. Other than that, James, my interests don't really lie with these cats. I mean, I appreciate that they're pretty and that they are phenomenally good hunters and that they are really the poster children for the bush out here. My interests lie with the smaller creatures around here. And so I have a bucket list which includes many dozens of insects and spiders and different types of arachnids and lizards and snakes. But I appreciate what I'm seeing. I mean, he is a good looking animal, there's no doubt. All right, and Brent has got a little bit of an update on those lions at the moment. So we'll stay here with Sindile until the end of the show and catch up with you in a little bit.
So there's a lot of feeding going on. Listen to that. It's amazing how quickly these cubs' voices are becoming so deep. Here we go. Mom's had enough. Doesn't want to let go. Complaining. Now imagine those little lion cubs' teeth are as sharp as little hypodermic needles. Just shows you how tough a lioness is. Thank you. So, Blobbit MacBlob, back to your question about would a group of lionesses eventually just get sick of a male and try to push him out. Not necessarily. What happened yesterday is there was a bit of a shift in dynamics which caused that fight yesterday. And we've had that limpy Birmingham who's been hanging around with that youngest Nkuhuma lioness, waiting for her to come into estrus. And I think we weren't there exactly, but I can speculate what happened. So there was that other Birmingham who was just lying on the peripheries, not getting involved. Every time he moved, he got growled at. But as soon as that lioness came into full estrus, he decided to take charge. And he hadn't been wasting energy following and keeping with her. So there was a fight between the males. And on top of that, a third male arrived, which also created pandemonium. And I think what happened is one of them got grumpy with the cubs or whatnot, and the three mothers went at that one male. And of course, in that situation, he got pushed out, but he'll be back. The lionesses are not going to completely push away any male from the Birmingham coalition. Because if he really wanted to, he could turn around and probably kill all three of those lionesses. As what happened when they came into this area, Gorma's lost. Sorry, just listening to that incredible sound. I think Nkuhuma's lost, I think it was three adult lionesses to the Birminghams during the coalition, and the one sub-adult, the sister of the youngest female who's about to start mating. So she managed to survive. And what you probably find during that takeover, these lionesses were defending, not Junior, as a lot of people thought, who was the young male who's now gone, but those young lionesses. Oh, look at that. Because the strength of a lion pride's genetics lies with the females. So all the females in a pride are going to be related. So looking after a female in the pride and the future of the pride is something that occasionally, not always, a lioness might risk her life for. Now, I had enough of being breakfast. The visuals aren't the best, the sounds are incredible. Tired of those incredible sounds. What a busy morning it's been. Leopard, lion, wild dog, elephants. Samsung says she wishes we could put a little color dab on each of the cubs so we could identify the individuals. Samsung, I'd like to watch if someone wants to go put some paint on a lion cub. I think Mom would be quite angry. As Herbert said, they were talking to him when he found them on foot today, which means they were growling quite aggressively. Well, good news for the sunset safari is that we're going to be right here, and we know where the lions are, and it's going to be a stinker today. Like, we could get over 30 degrees Celsius, so it's unlikely that these lions are going to move too far. And if they do move from here, they're probably going to move towards the Galago Pan or the Vuyatela Pan. Hello, Lauren in Illinois. Lauren would like to know when cubs are first introduced to the pride, between that 6 and 8 week period, how long will it take for them to feel comfortable enough to aloe suckle on the other lionesses? Well, Lauren, it generally happens within a day or two. And you must remember, lions, although... lions aren't, I don't want to call them stupid, but they're not smart. So a lot of what happens with most of the animals, particularly the predators, like the big cats, is a lot of those things are instinctive. So it's taken many, many, many years of evolution to develop those things. And all those little traits are to help for the survival of the species. So I think probably it might even happen on the first day. As soon as they see a lactating female, they'll go for it. And the lionesses will put up with cubs that are not their own. So it looks like the females are going to head now down deeper into this little ravine where it's probably a bit cooler, lie in the cool sand. And unfortunately, I don't know if we're going to be able to get a vehicle in there. And it looks like some of the cubs are starting to follow as well. And the last lioness is on the move. Is that a male on the other side? I think I can see a male lion on the other side of the ravine. I'm not sure if you guys are going to be able to see it from here. Let me just double check. Or it could be one of the other lionesses. Oh, so much bush. Okay. I can't really see. I just see a lion leg on the other side of the drainage line. And it's just... it is a male. So one of the Birminghams is lying on the other side. Now, I wonder who that is. Is it the victor from last night with the scars all over his face? But all the lions have disappeared down into the little ravine. So we'll try and maneuver to get one last view. I don't think it's going to be possible. So while we do that, let's go see how Steph's doing with Sindile.
And we are still with this young male leopard. He's now lying up at the base of the tree, slightly different to where he was. Just lying up. I think what he's doing is he's getting a bit hot. The sun is intense at the moment. I'm feeling it beating down upon my neck. He's just breathing there, belly full, very content. That is a happy leopard. Love this profile of his face. Leopard skulls are actually almost completely oval. Now, what we're not seeing there is the fact that the nose, which is cartilaginous, not bony, hides that round. So there, that's a perfect line to see how a leopard's skull is. You can see that almost oval look because you can't see his nose. His nose protrudes out and breaks that. But even from the front, you recognize that roundness. Now, if you have a look at a leopard's skull from the front, it's actually triangular. The roundness comes from muscles which are attached to the lower jaw, which give leopard their bite force. But now if you follow that line, take off the nose and follow that line from the forehead down to the front lip, you will see that it's an almost completely oval skull from this side profile. And that, if you look at a pair of garden shears, that shearing motion, that absolute power that you get from an oval or a circular shearing motion is what gives leopard their incredible bite force. And it's just a marvel of creation and of form following function when you see how well these cats are actually designed and adapted. So Diamond, you've just asked how many years will this cat most likely live for and how many years do leopard live for? Leopard usually live between 12 and 16 years, with the odd exception getting to 18 years that I've heard of through the ether. And the reason why that is in this particular area is mainly because this area is jam-packed with predators. Lots of hyena, lots of other male leopard, lots of lion. And that's generally what get leopard down, or the cause of the end. But starvation, I heard a report when I was a young guard once of them doing some tests on the bones of leopard and figuring out that leopard go through these feast and famine stages in development, where things go very good for them and then things don't go so good for them. And it's evident in their bone structure. So I think it's pretty typical of how leopard live out here. One day is good, the next day they've spent 2 weeks not finding anything or being chased around. Let's come to that part of the day where I have to unfortunately say goodbye to you for now. But I just have to say from myself and from Brian, and I also would like to say from Brent and from David today, that thank you very, very much for coming aboard with us today. Thank you for all your questions and concerns. There's the thumb making an appearance and saying goodbye to all of you. From the two ladies, Kirsten and Louise in final control, and from the rest of the team that makes this possible, thank you very, very much. And to, of course, all of you, thank you very, very much for your support, your questions, watching what we do, being part of the community, welcoming all the new viewers. And we will see you soon again, 3 o'clock Central Africa time. Look after yourselves. All the best wherever you are. Bye-bye.